Thank you. Thanks, Vicky. Hello. So yeah, I'm a filmmaker from Quebec City. I live in Toronto now, and since graduating in film production and film studies from the University of British Columbia 5 years ago, I've directed one feature film, a few short films, a documentary, and for the last 2 years or so, been directing commercials as well. So I guess what I want to talk about today is the unpredictable trajectory of having a creative career, and share how I've managed sort of all its ups and downs, and how I've actually come to embrace that journey, which is full of unexpected twists and turns. So, and yeah, before I begin, just, you know, I guess I want to preface by saying I myself am very much still at the start of my career, but hopefully you can glean some nuggets of useful information in what I say. So I thought I'd start by just showing you one of the last projects I did, which is a 2-minute little short film that I put out last year. So I'm gonna share my screen, full screen.
Those beautiful.
Yes, and then after that,
we're gonna go to Paris, which is my last place.
So yeah, just a bit about my background. I grew up in Quebec City. We have, you know, super long winters where you have to just find something to do. So for me, it was snowboarding. It just became like a full-on obsession. I would do it every day of the weekend, every day that I could, even after school. And I thought, you know, in my 14, 15-year-old mind that I would become a pro snowboarder and go to the Olympics and do X Games and all that sort of stuff. But yeah, when I was 15 and 16, a set of injuries kind of sidelined me, and my friends and I, we would always film each other just kind of for fun. But when I got hurt, I sort of became the designated filmer and editor. And so for those next 3 years, yeah, that sort of turned in actually into this little ski and snowboard film production company where we would premiere our films at Laval University, where, you know, we would sell our films to local ski shops with help from local sponsors and things like that. So I'll just like show you a super quick clip to give you a sense of where I came from.
I'm straight old promo, right back to it. Back to the point where I gotta spit through it. It's money in them streets, I gotta go pursue it. I'm the truest, you know that night produced. It's on this promo loop, the flow addiction to the streets. I'm tired, like my mom was too tense. I couldn't fathom the sight of me losing. Any Malcolm X Boulevard, I'm about movement. I'm getting money, I don't need your 2 cents. The structure been built way before the blueprint. They got me back on the block again, back with the rockers again. Watching for cops again, all about the droppin'. They got me back in this game again, but I swear, we all gonna be alright. I'm back on the block again, back.
Cool. So I just want to make it clear that that was not me. That's my friend Frank, who is infinitely better than me. But yeah, so that's how it kind of all started. And I think at that point, I didn't know film was like my thing necessarily, but I kind of knew like that whatever I would do later in life would be sort of project-based. I just really, really enjoyed working on a project for an extensive period of time. Through various different stages to finally be able to share it, but also have kind of something to show for all the work that I put in. So I get, yeah, my first little, in my notes here, my first little header is the path to success is rejection and failure, part one. And it sounds harsh, but hear me out. So I went to University of British Columbia, and the way the film production program works there is that you kind of study whatever arts in first year, then you apply to the film production program, which only takes 20 students. And then in your first year there, you have all these intro classes. In your third year, we vote among students for 6 scripts to get made. So if your script isn't chosen, you end up producing or DPing or editing your fellow students' work. And then in the fourth year, you get to do whatever you want. So got to UBC thinking, yeah, I think film might be for me, applied, and lo and behold, I didn't get in because all I had to show was ski films. I guess that's what not what they were really looking for. And then in my second year, just I made this little short film with my iPhone, and that's what got me in the next year. And by that point, I knew kind of already, like I had this big, great short film that I wanted to make. Lo and behold, got to that point where we were voting and my film didn't get picked, which was a huge blow, an enormous bummer, but figured like, okay, well, at least I'll just produce 3 short films for my friends while keeping my focus on prepping for the following year. This is what I thought was this sort of great magnum opus student film. And then finally, in my final year of university, I made that film, and my mindset at that point, when it was like pretty much done, I thought, wait till they see this. Like, that's kind of where I was at. And, you know, sent it to like 100 film festivals, and it got picked by 1 to play. And to me, immediately back then, it made me feel like my film was a failure. Like, it wasn't very good. It didn't get picked. And it's really sad to say, but it made me hate my film. Like, oh, I just didn't make something that's good enough. Which brings me to my next chapter. You know, my first chapter was the path to success is rejection, failure. And now it's actually, but what is success? So after a year of this failure of a short film, I rewatched it. I don't know why, but I sat down and I watched it and I really liked it. And it meant a lot to me, and it still does. And, you know, the way it's made isn't perfect, but it was made with a lot of heart. And I just kind of, it just hit me like, I actually like this film. And I had at that moment, this sort of epiphany of thinking you should equate success with the completion of a project, getting to the finish line, completing a film, that's success. And anything else is just gravy. So I'll just show you a little clip from Nephew, that short film.
Hi.
Hi there.
Hi.
What can I do for you?
I'm looking for someone.
And who's that?
George Fontaine.
He's out back. Wasn't down. Want me to get him for you?
No, that's okay. Does he work here?
Yep.
Just out back. Thank you.
Yep, you bet.
So that was Nephew. So equating success, which is the completion of a project. And I think by switching that mindset and becoming much more process oriented rather than goal oriented, I was able to, I think, find so much more joy in just like what I made rather than hinging, you know, my pride in what I did on accolades, as silly and kind of sad as that sounds. So after university, went right into kind of applying for all these grants to make this feature film. Named the grant, I applied for it, got rejected, reapplied, finally just got the one, but was able to make this film with, you know, Kickstarter backers from a previous project, made it with friends, just made it with lots of favors, and was able to release it, which I'm really proud of. So I guess I could just go on and on about just multiple kind of failures and rejections just in the last year or two, you know, but I think you get the point. And I think what I've learned is we tend to attach a sort of sense of finality with outcomes of certain projects, to winning or not winning a prize and so on. But there's just such a domino effect to what initially might feel like such a blow, that down the line you can trace back that moment to the reason why your new film or your new project turned into something that you're really happy with. And something that I think about a lot is there's this, I don't know how to say it, like the Chinese Zen fable or story that I think about a lot, and I'm not gonna try and butcher it, but in a nutshell, it's the story of 1,000 years ago with this farmer who had a horse and his horse ran away. And people at the village said, "Oh my God, we're so sorry. That's such horrible luck." And the farmer says, "Good luck, bad luck, who knows?" And a week later, the horse came back with 5 wild horses, which he kept. And people at the village said, "Oh my God, that's incredible. Such great luck." And he says, "Good luck, bad luck, who knows?" And a few weeks later, his son is trying to tame one of the horses, falls off, breaks his leg. People in the village, "Oh my God, such horrible luck. Good luck, bad luck, who knows?" And then a war breaks out and the army comes through the village looking for young able-bodied men to join the army. Of course, the son has a broken leg, can't do it. People at the village, "Ah, such great luck. Oh my God, you get to have your son stay around." And the farmer says, "Good luck, bad luck, who knows?" So it goes on and on and on. And I think that totally applies to having like a creative career where, you know, not winning a job or having a project fall apart out of what initially feels like bad luck or rejection or a failure can come something great. And something that I think I've done is use these rejections and so on as fuel, actually, to keep going and never to take no for an answer. And always sort of setting out with a plan A, a plan B, C, and D, and so on of how to make that project come to life. And actually using limitations of budget, of restrictions in time, and use like transforming that into strengths. So I'm almost running out of time, but just to end, I'd say, yeah, something that's helped me tremendously is sort of making plans and setting goals, long and short term. Just something that I can keep track of, you know, and this journey or path or whatever will sort of veer in such unexpected ways, but at least having this direction in which to move forward, I think has been super helpful. I think it's important to take risks, like what feels like massive risks, and invest in yourself. And I think until you invest in yourself in a way, not just in a money way, but until you do that, no one will invest in you. And I think something that I'd heard many years ago, but I only sort of clocked in or sort of clued in to what that really meant a few years ago is, you know, as a creative, don't try to be anyone else. You know, everyone else is taken and there's only one you, and your perspective is what makes you unique. And all you can do is really be the most you you can be. And that's what will make your films true to you and stand out, but then also ultimately kind of really universal and relatable. So the process of making ski films with friends back then, now I feel like I'm kind of back there in the last few years, making films with friends, with people who I care about, hopefully ones that matter a bit more than ski films, and have perhaps some sort of cultural relevance, but or definitely resonate with people. But having just being process oriented, and just making the film for the purposes of just making a film, and telling a story or sharing an experience, and the way you make it, the people you make it with, will inevitably sort of bleed into to what the film is itself, and that'll be undeniable. I think that's time for me. So thanks. And yeah, Vicky, if we have questions, down for that.
Yeah, we have one question right now. Question from the audience is, why was the topic of your iPhone film that got you into film school?
Yeah, so it was called Face It. It's on my Vimeo, deep in there. And it was about kind of like a week in the life of like a young woman living her university life. And it was called Face It, but we kind of never saw her face and just followed her all from behind the whole time. I think back then shooting with your iPhone like 8 or 9 years ago was like interesting and kind of new, and had that sort of, you know, I guess the quality wasn't like as incredible as it is now, but had this quality of like realism to it, which made it stand out. And again, I think I touched on using limitations and turning them into strengths. And I think that's a pretty good example. You know, I just didn't know how to operate a camera. I didn't know how to, or like, you know, like a real cinema camera, and figured like, okay, I have no money. I'm just going to make this with my phone. And we filmed it over months, just like very, like, I think there's like 100, but just really short scenes. And shooting with my phone was also a way of just shooting anywhere, you know, inside like maybe a nightclub or in a classroom during a class without calling any attention to myself. And what started as, yeah, a limitation turned into being like such a huge part of the aesthetic of that film. So.
Interesting. We have another question from the audience. What are you currently directing right now?
So I guess what I'm currently directing, I'm in the process of editing right now. I was fortunate to shoot a new little short film, kind of very much in line with what I showed earlier on, You Know Where You Belong. But this time around, again, a very short 2-minute, I guess you could say, conceptual little short film. And it's about connection in a time where we can't physically touch. So it has to do with, these physical greetings that we have that, you know, have been adapted in this new age. And I'm actually super proud of it. We shot it on film. We shot it in Vancouver early in October, and it's going to come out online in 2 weeks or so. So that's what I'm working on. And then also writing a new short film that I'm aiming to shoot next summer.
Exciting times right now. Another one is, what's your dream film project?
That's a good question. I've never thought of it that way. I don't know. I definitely do make plans, I guess not that long in advance. I've never thought of a dream film project. I think the dream film project is the next feature film that I'm going to do, and I don't exactly know what shape it will take. I'm still writing it and working on it, but yeah, that's the one. You know, whether I shoot in 2 years or 3 years, that'll be the next dream project for sure. But also sometimes, yeah, embracing the unexpected. Things happen around you that you just can't avoid in a way. An example of this is 2 years ago, one of my best friends called me saying he just met his father for the first time at 28 years old, this Rwandan man who had been living really close to him, who didn't know he had a son until the day they met. And so we went to Rwanda 3 weeks later and spent like a month and made a whole film about that story. And that turned into actually a film about the relationship between identity and family. And that's coming out right now in a few festivals and coming out online early next year. So the dream project, yeah, is the next feature film. It's still very nebulous about what shape it'll take. But yeah, something, the next film that I'll write and direct. But yeah, still staying open to kind of whatever kind of opportunities may happen.
Do you write all of your short films?
I have, yeah. All my short films I've written. The feature film that I did, I co-wrote with my friend Darren, who's a writer. And that was a really, really great experience. And we'll do it again on when the right idea comes along. But yeah, it just sort of happened that way so far that I've written my own things. And I think that goes along with when you're starting your career and giving yourself opportunities. I always thought of myself as a director and then as a writer. But when you're starting, there aren't like any scripts around laying around for you to like pick up and direct. So you kind of just have to do it yourself. So it just kind of came out of necessity. But yeah, so far that's what's happened. But open to directing a script I haven't written. That's something I haven't done yet, but I'm really eager to try that one day. But until then, I'll just keep writing the films myself.
Great response. What is the favorite film to watch? Is there a film that inspires you?
Yeah, I totally have like an answer to that. And it's this French film called La Haine, and it's by Mathieu Kassovitz, and it came out in 1995. And it's, for those who don't know, it's just kind of a day in the life of young kids in the projects outside of Paris, the day after huge riots, and a friend of theirs is in the hospital in critical condition, and one of the friends vows to kill a cop if their friend dies. That's the premise. And it's one of my favorite films because I think it's the first film that I saw maybe, you know, over 10 years ago where I clued into what a director did. The style and the mise-en-scène is so explosive and showy, stylized and stylish, but it just supports the story and the characters so well. It's all very purposeful, and it blows me away. So it's definitely one of those films that I've seen a lot and probably watch at least once a year, just for fun or just to kind of get inspired, because every time I see it, I just pick up on something new. Whether it be just this little bit of sound design or this little bit of clever storytelling that's interweaved into the film. That and the fact that it's just such an incredible topic that's still completely relevant today, sadly. La Haine, yeah, really great film.
Okay, I think that wraps up everything. We've reached our time and there are no more questions. We hope that this session was informative and you've learned more about what it's like to work in the creative industry as a filmmaker in commercial production. We appreciate your time. And as you start the application process or to explore where your talents fit in the creative industry, be sure to visit creativefutures.ca. We have another, we have two sessions scheduled for tomorrow afternoon, 2 and 3 o'clock. If you haven't already registered, you can do so by visiting creativefutures.ca and click on speaker series. Thank you, David, and to everyone for joining us.
Thank you.